Howdy. Man, it's good to be with you all this morning. You know, the most famous of all the stories in the Arabian Nights is the story of Aladdin. How many of you have read the book? Wow, really? We are way more cultured than I thought for a Parker County church. I'll be honest with you. I know a handful of us then have read the book, but how many of you have seen the movie? Okay, that's what I was expecting. Just to kind of refresh your memories, here's the scene where this poor boy Aladdin and his pet monkey find this old little lamp and rub it and meet the genie. Remember this? Check this out.
Whoever he was, he's long gone with that lamp. Why, you hairy little thief. Looks like such a beat up, worthless piece of junk. Hey, I think there's something written here, but it's hard to make out.
Why? 10,000 years will give you such a crick in the neck. Hang on a second. Whoa! Wow! Does it feel good to be out of there? How are you? Nice to be back, ladies and gentlemen. Hi, where are you from? What's your name?
Aladdin.
Aladdin! Hello, Aladdin. Nice to have you on the show. Can we call you Al? Or maybe just Din? Or how about Ladi? Sounds like, here, boy. Come on, Ladi.
I must have hit my head harder than I thought.
Do you smoke? Mind if I do? Oh, sorry, Cheetah. I hope I didn't singe the fur. Yo, Rugman. Haven't seen you in a few millennia. Give me some tassel. Yeah, yo, yo. Say, you're a lot smaller than my last master. Either that or I'm getting bigger. Look at me from the side. Do I look different to you?
Wait a minute. I'm your master?
That's right. He can be taught. What would you wish of me?
Be ever impressive.
The one contained. But never duplicated. Genie of the lamp. Right here, direct from the lamp, right here for your very much wish fulfillment. Thank you.
Whoa. Wish fulfillment?
3 wishes to be exact. An ixnay on the wishing for more wishes. That's it. 3. Uno, dos, tres. No substitutions, exchanges, or refund.
Robin Williams was the best. Man. So 3 wishes, right? He finds the lamp, out pops the genie, and he gets 3 wishes. And maybe there's something just compelling with us about that story. I don't know what it is, but maybe, if we're just being honest, at the heart of it is, man, that would be so cool if I could, you know, find a lamp and out pop the genie and get 3 wishes, whatever I wanted. Well, this morning in Scripture, we're going to look at the closest thing the Bible has to an Aladdin moment with this guy named Solomon. And I can't wait to show it to you, but first, would you pray with me? All right? So, God, we're about to read your holy word, and I pray that you would fill me with your Holy Spirit and fill all those who are listening with your Holy Spirit, that we may hear and receive and believe and download and install and apply and live out your truth today. Your Spirit's a spirit of grace and truth, and so pour yourself out, we pray right now, in Jesus' great name. And everybody agreed and said, amen. All right, so find the book of 1 Kings chapter 3. If you're using the Bibles we provide for you, that's page 351, or however you choose to get in God's Word, we have the YouVersion Bible app, and you can follow along with that if you would like as well. So, okay, about 3,000 years ago, the year is about 970 BC, Solomon now is in charge of the nation of Israel. His father David, his predecessor, through military might and warfare and strategy and courage, rose Israel up to its place of worldwide dominance. And now his son Solomon is riding the wave, and they are at the peak. These are the golden years of the kingdom of Solomon, all right? And he takes over as the king. And watch this transition take place. Here's some of the first things that he does. 1 Kings chapter 3. So then Solomon formed a marriage alliance with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and took Pharaoh's daughter and brought her to the city of David until he had finished building his own house and the house of the Lord and the wall around Jerusalem. The people were still sacrificing on high places because there was no house built for the name of the Lord until those days. Now let me just pause real quick. The pagan nations around them would go to the high places and sacrifice to their gods. I actually got to see the remnants of this when I was in Mexico a few weeks ago. We were in the mountains, and there was this remnant of this little stone altar they'd built with a candle in the middle, and they had done some kind of service to their god. They go up in the high place in the mountain, and they do these little pagan worship services, okay? The Israelites adapted that practice. Now, verse 3, Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David, except he sacrificed and burnt incense on the high places. The king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place, and Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on the altar. So here we see the greatness and the kryptonite, if you will, the downfall of Solomon, all right here in verse 3. It says that Solomon loved the Lord just like his dad did, except... How do you think that would go in your relationships with your special loved ones? Hey, honey, I love you, except. I love you, except when you put on weight. I love you, except when you burn the roast. How do you think that would go down? Not very well. Neither with the Lord. It says he loved the Lord, except he offered the burnt or sacrifices in the high places. I don't think necessarily Solomon's heart was wrong in wanting to sacrifice and worship God. He just did it in the wrong places. So in spite of all that, verse 5, God meets him in a dream. In Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream at night and said, "Ask what you wish me to give you." Here's the Aladdin moment. All right? So Solomon gets to meet with God, and God comes to him and says, "Ask what you wish." Wow. What an amazing moment. Now here's Solomon. He has the ear of the God of the universe saying, "What do you want? Ask for it." So what do you ask for if you're Solomon? You're the king of Israel. What do you ask for? Verse 6, here's what he asked for. Then Solomon said, "You have shown great loving kindness to your servant David, my father, according as he walked before you in truth and righteousness and uprightness of heart toward you. And you have reserved for him this great loving kindness that you have given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day. Now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, yet I am but a little child. I do not know how to go out or come in. Your servant is in the midst of your people, which you have chosen, a great people who are too many to be numbered or counted. So, here's his request. Give your servant an understanding heart to judge your people, to discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of yours?" Man, Solomon shows tremendous humility. He's the king of the most powerful nation in the world and a young guy. And generally speaking, when young people achieve this kind of wealth and this kind of power and this kind of fame at a young age, it's more about hubris than humility, if we're just being honest. But Solomon says, "God, I'm young. I don't know how to do this. And there's a whole lot of people out there. So God, here's my wish. Give me wisdom. Give me a discerning heart so I can rule your people." And you know what? God loved that request. Verse 10. It was pleasing in the sight of the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. God said to him, "Because you have asked this thing and have not asked for yourself long life, nor have asked riches for yourself, nor has asked for the life of your enemies," normal things that normal men would have asked for, "but have asked for yourself discernment to understand justice, behold, I have done according to your words. Behold, I have given you a wise and discerning heart, so that there has been no one like you before you, nor shall one like you arise after you. I have also given what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that there will not be any among the kings like you all your days. If you walk by my ways, keeping my statutes and commandments as your father David walked, then I will prolong your days." Wow. God opened up heaven on Solomon. I remember what C.S. Lewis said. He said, "If you aim at heaven, you get earth thrown in. But if you aim at earth, you get neither." Well, beloved, in his request, Solomon aimed at heaven. And he got all the earth thrown in. Riches and power and fame. Everything that he could have asked for but didn't. He got it all. All right? Now, Solomon gets wisdom unlike any person ever. What happens next, I think, is an indicator of that wisdom applied to his life. All right? First, we'll call it personal wisdom. The first thing he does, verse 15, notice, is really important. Then Solomon awoke from his dream, and behold, it was a dream, and he came to Jerusalem and stood before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord and offered burnt offerings and made peace offerings and made a feast for all his servants. So there it is. I'll call that personal wisdom. So God gives Solomon wisdom unlike any person in the history of the world. And instead, you remember back in verses 3 through 5, he offered sacrifices on the high places where the pagan people did. Now he goes to Jerusalem before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, the very presence of God, and now he's offering sacrifices. Now he's getting it right. Now he's doing it on God's terms, in God's way, in God's place. That's personal wisdom, is getting right with God on God's terms. That's first things first. That's where wisdom begins. Look at what the scripture says, Proverbs 9:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Hey, friends and neighbors, just straight up, you cannot expect to have supernatural wisdom if you do not know the supernatural one. This is where wisdom begins, is when you get right with God on God's terms, which we believe is through Jesus Christ, his Son. That's personal wisdom. And then if you'll notice, he gets it right with God. And then the very last line is, he made a feast for all of his servants. I'll just call that overflow. When you get it right with God and when you come to faith in Jesus Christ and he fills your life, there's an overflow out of your life that blesses all of those around you. That's Christianity. You love God and you love one another. Solomon got it right. First step in personal wisdom. But now, let's call it judicial wisdom. This is one of the most famous stories in Scripture. It's even on Wikipedia called The Judgment of Solomon. All right? Here it is, verse 16. Then two women who were harlots came to the king and stood before him. The one woman said, "Oh, my lord, this woman and I live in the same house, and I gave birth to a child while she was in the house. It happened on the third day after I gave birth that this woman also gave birth to a child, and we were together. There was no stranger with us in the house, only the two of us in the house. This woman's son died in the night because she lay on it. So she arose in the middle of the night and took my son from me, from beside me, while your maidservant slept, and laid him in her bosom and laid her dead son in my bosom. And when I rose in the morning to nurse my son, behold, he was dead. But when I looked at him carefully in the morning, behold, he was not my son, whom I had born. Then the other woman said, 'No, for the living one is my son, and the dead one is your son.' But the first woman said, 'No, for the dead one is your son, and the living one is my son.' And thus they spoke before the king." You see what's going on here? So then the king said, "Get me a sword," is what he said, verse 24. "Get me a sword." So they brought a sword before the king, and the king said, "Divide the living child in two, and give half to the one and half to the other." Then the woman whose child was the living one spoke to the king, for she was deeply stirred over her son, and said, "Oh, my lord, give her the living child, and by no means kill him." But the other said, "He shall be neither mine nor yours. Divide him." Then the king said, "Give the first woman the living child, and by no means kill him. She is the mother." Judicial wisdom, supernatural wisdom that God gave Solomon to know who the real mother was in this instance, because God gave Solomon enough wisdom to know that the truest aspect of the heart of a mom is sacrificial love for her children. And this mom was willing to sacrifice herself, if you will, and her life and her time so that her son could live. And so he got to the heart of the issue, he got to the heart of the mother and found out who the real mother was. Judicial wisdom. I remember I have a friend who has two sons, and he knew this story, and it happened that this is when, many years ago, his sons were young, and I think it was a G.I. Joe doll, and they were fighting over whose G.I. Joe doll it was, all right? So they come to the dad, and they said, "Billy's got my doll." "No, that's my doll." "No, it's my doll." "No, it's my doll." Well, so dad knows this story, all right? And he says, "I know what I'm going to do." So he says to his sons, "Sons, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to go get a big knife, and we're going to cut this in half. and you can each have a half of the G.I. Joe doll. And the boys kind of stop in their tracks, and their jaw drops, and they turn and look at one another, and they look back at their dad and say, cool, awesome, I'm so cool, Dad. So anyway, didn't quite work, all right, for Dad. Didn't quite have the effect that he was hoping. But wisdom nonetheless, all right. So it doesn't always work quite this way, maybe in real life, but this is judicial wisdom of the supernatural kind, all right? So first he takes God's wisdom and he applies it to himself, getting right with God on God's terms. Next he takes the wisdom of God and applies it to judge the people, to have discernment, all right? But this is Solomon. This is 3,000 years ago. This is over 7,000 miles away from us right now. What about us? What's your story? What's our story? Let me share it with you. Here's your story, beloved. Here's your Aladdin moment. It's found in the book of James, chapter 1. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Hey, beloved, here you go. God is offering to you to give you wisdom. Notice the second line here. How is God going to give you wisdom? When you ask for wisdom from God, how does God deal with you? Number one, he said he gives generously all that you need and more. Secondly, he will give it to all. He doesn't care who you are, how old you are. If you're 5 and you need wisdom, ask God and he'll give it to you. And without finding fault. When you ask God for wisdom so that you can make the right decision, a prudent decision, and need discernment so that you can lead a prudent life, that's not a time when God goes on a fault-finding mission with you. He receives that. And he's blessed by that. The only caveat for us is when we ask, we got to believe it. I mean, really believe it. So friends and neighbors, my beloved, may I ask you a personal question? If God said he'll give you wisdom when you ask for it, do you believe it? If you do, you will have it. You will have it. And notice, first, just like with Solomon, the first thing when God gives you wisdom, the first thing you'll do is get right with him on his terms through Jesus Christ. I remember reading a parabolic story about a father and a son who loved art, and they loved to go to different art shows and collect it and study it. Well, the son went off to war in Vietnam and unfortunately was killed in battle, leaving the dad without an heir. So he goes on and lives the rest of his life and still appreciating and collecting art, and by the time he dies, he has this massive and very valuable art collection. And so because he had no heir when he dies, he puts it all up for auction. But before he died, he got a knock on the door. And it was a soldier who had served in the war with his son. And he says, "Sir, I know that you don't know me, but your son saved my life in the war. So over these past several months, I've been working on this portrait of a son. I'm not that great at it, but I did my best, and I just want to give you this painting of the son that your son that I did for you, just as a token of my gratitude and appreciation." Well, the dad, the art collector, took that novicely done painting and put it on top of his mantle. It was his favorite work of art, so super special to him. And so sure enough, when he dies and this auction comes around, the very first piece to be displayed and put up for auction is that painting of his son. Now again, remember, it's not professionally or really super well done, but it's meant a lot to him. So he put it up for auction first. So the auctioneer begins. He says, "Who will give me 100? Silence. "Who will give me 50? Still silence. And then there's kind of rumbling, because everybody knows this piece isn't really worth anything. All right? So there's rumbling in the crowd. And finally, "Who will give me 25? Finally, from the back, the gardener of the family estate shouts out and says, "I'll give you $10. 10 going once, 10 going twice, sold $10 to the gardener in the back. And then the auctioneer says this. He says, ladies and gentlemen, I now get to inform you that the auction is over. I was given a secret and special instruction that whoever got the son gets it all. You see, beloved, in the spiritual life, he who gets the son gets it all. When you aim at heaven, you get earth thrown in. When you ask God for supernatural wisdom, wisdom is the one downloadable quality of life that has a positive influence on every area and aspect of your life. He who gets the son gets it all. That's wisdom. And the cool thing is, you don't just have to ask God for it. God wrote it down for us. So this same guy, Solomon, who God gave supernatural wisdom to like none before and none after, he wrote it down for us. If you'll turn the page in 1 Kings 4 and look at verse 29, you'll see this. That God gave Solomon wisdom and very great discernment and breadth of mind like the sand that is on the seashore. And Solomon's wisdom surpassed the wisdom of all the sons of the east and all the wisdom of Egypt. And if you'll skip down to verse 32 so I don't have to pronounce all those names. All right. He also spoke 3,000 proverbs, and his songs were 1,005. He wrote proverbs down. And if you'll open to about the middle of your Bible, you'll find 31 chapters of them right in here. They're not all from Solomon, but I think the vast majority of them are. Proverbs, short sayings of wisdom, divine wisdom given to Solomon like no man in the history, and he wrote them down for you, so that you could gain and glean wisdom for your life today. Matter of fact, here's the very first one. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 1. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel, for gaining wisdom and instruction, for understanding words of insight, for receiving instruction in prudent behavior, doing what is right and just and fair. And here's verse 8. Listen, my son, to your father's instruction, and do not forsake your mother's teaching. They are a garland to grace your head and a chain to adorn your neck. In other words, they're going to make you a more attractive person inside and out. And so you see, my beloved, if you want wisdom for your life, you don't have to hope that you find an old lamp and rub it and a genie pops out. Man, you just need to ask God and believe. Read the scripture, and listen to your mom and dad. Amen? All right, let's pray.